What's up again, everybody? I am DM Armada, and today we're going to do a full and complete walkthrough of a sealed deck building session so that you can get some tips or some ideas, some processes to work through when you build your own sealed deck. And the reason that's important is because if you hadn't heard, the upcoming two callings, the calling Dallas-Fort Worth and the calling Cincinnati, are both sealed and draft, so they're limited formats for the main event. If you would like to win money playing card games, you can go to those events, you can open packs like we're about to do, you can build decks, and you can win the game. If you can pull those things off, you could win some money and some pretty sweet prizes. So I'm going to talk you through my process. We're going to crack open this fresh box, and today we're talking through how I build a sealed deck, okay? I have done this many times in Flesh and Blood. I think this is my favorite format because it's just so easy. It's so easy to build a sealed deck. I don't know, all the formats are really good. But essentially, if you don't know how sealed works, first of all, go check my channel out, youtube.com/DMArmada. I made an entire video, a deep dive into the sealed format for Flesh and Blood with all the kind of rules, particulars, and that sort of thing. But here's the quick and dirty. You're going to get yourself six packs. They're going to be passed to you most likely. And after you've gotten six packs, everyone is going to have time to open these packs, sort them, and build a sealed deck with them. The sealed deck is a minimum of 30 cards. You can add more than 30 cards. You can only use equipment that you pull, which is important in this set because equipment is not as readily available. For example, in this pack, we may find a piece of equipment, or we may find an amulet, which is the replacement of equipment in certain packs, and that is a very important thing as we go. I'm going to just kind of rifle through these very quickly, separating them into random stacks first, a Mark of Lightning. Those are the kinds of things you want to keep in mind. After we open all of our packs, we're going to sort them by elements, so Earth, Lightning, Ice. I'm gonna put the token over there. The tokens, by the way, go just off to the side somewhere. They go off and you don't worry about them. We're gonna separate these into Earth, Lightning, Ice, and then into class cards. Explosive Growth and Weave Earth, followed by a Veliflash foil. We got the Rotten Old Buckler. Those you wanna keep in mind. Any type of equipment that you get in your sealed pool is good. And I do wanna point this out. Some people say, and I've heard it said, some people say that sealed is sort of luck of the draw in a term. And yes, you can have better sealed pools, you can have worse sealed pools, but it's up to the player to kind of put that deck together and really figure out, oh, hey, look at this, a Cold Foil Deep Blue. That's on my list of Cold Foils that I've actually wanted. How fun is that? That's a beautiful card and very playable in this set. One that we want to keep in mind because Deep Blue is one of the best equipments for limited, in my opinion. As far as just fixing resource bases, that is an incredibly important thing in general to do. And if you can do that with something like Deep Blue, which you can play in any class at all. Hey, there's a Channel Mount Heroic. That's an important one to keep in mind as well. Foil Summerwood Shelter Red. Oh, Cracker Jacks is so good to see as well. If you're building a sealed deck and you have a Cracker Jacks, that is a very good time because Cracker Jacks, again, can fit into literally everything. It is one of the two generic, or one of the several generics, I should say. The other one that's really good is Deep Blue, of course. And yeah, if you see a Cracker Jacks, you can do some pretty powerful things. So we got a, look at this Majestic pull. Oh my God, look at the Majestics. This is gonna be the craziest sealed pool ever. What are we doing over here? I should just stop making a sealed pool and open the rest of the box at this point. Or maybe I shouldn't, because all the spice has been pulled already. That's kind of crazy. But again, we're opening six packs, cracking them, and then after that, I'm going to sort them into like piles, and then we'll take a look at our distributions and see what we get. Dude, I'm so pumped about some of these pulls. Some of these are really good. Lightning Surge is also a really good card. Lightning Surge Red is like one that you definitely want to see if you want to play Lightning. So After just opening, we already have like some very interesting things to think about as far as Majestics are concerned. Channel Mount Heroic's fantastic and limited. But let's separate these out into element piles, into class cards, and we'll go from there. Okay, so we have these split into piles. We have equipment, we've got Majestics over here. I do like to separate out Majestics if you do get multiples, just so that you can review those either first or last and see if that pulls you in a certain direction. But really what you're going to be looking at are these cards up here. These are your Lightning, your Ice, and your Earth cards. I think that card pool is the generic card pool of this set, and it's what you should keep your eyes on throughout your deck building process. As you're separating your cards out, as you're considering your possible like play lines, things that you could be playing into, class choices, basically anything you could possibly think about. It probably starts from here and then from these elemental cards that are generic elementals. So we're going to look at those first, but then of course I do also have these down here in class by Ranger and then Guardian and then Runeblade. So let's hack through each of these stacks as we go. First things first, I guess we could take a look at the equipment. We have Mark of Lightning, which is fantastic. In fact, I think we have two Mark of Lightnings. We do. Of course, you only can run one, so it doesn't matter if you have two. Cracker Jacks, you're going to play in just about everything unless you play Mark of Lightning. So we do have an unfortunate overlap in that respect. We got a lot of arm equipment. So Cracker Jacks does have more utility overall if we're playing something that's not Lightning. Obviously, we're going to play Cracker Jacks. Rotten Old Buckler is a good one if you plan to play Oldham, and you can't play it anywhere else. And then, of course, we did get a Cold Foil, and that Cold Foil is Deep Blue, probably the best possible scenario for an equipment that you can get, because you can run it in everything, and you probably do run it over every other chest equipment unless you pull a Legendary. So very open as far as chest equipment goes, and then after that, we're basically choosing if we're going to play Lightning, we're going to run these most likely, and if we're not, we're going to run Cracker Jacks, or if we don't like our Lightning pool, we're going to run Cracker Jacks. Majestic-wise, I think Channel Mount Heroic is our like best-case scenario card. It's the best of the Majestics that we pulled. Namely because if you don't play it, it still blocks three and it does have a beneficial effect. You just play it down, it can make your attacks cost three. You can play it in Oldham, which is great. You can play it in Briar, which can be good as well if you have enough blues to pay for it. Super good card. Fulminate, I am not crazy about in general, period, end of story. Cost two, pitches yellow, blocks two. If you play it in Briar, it makes a ton of sense because you can pitch Earth and Lightning, but giving plus three, I don't know, we already have a card that does that. So it is cheaper, I guess, and it is an elemental action, so we might want to play this if it's in Briar, you do fuse it with a Lightning card, it does give go again, which can be good. So it is something to consider there. And then Lexi has access to a foil Majestic Ice Storm, which is an Ice and a Lightning fusion. And even if you don't fuse this card, it has benefit because it does just give plus three. But if you manage to fuse it, it does get very gross, and you can tack on stuff after the fact with like Mark of Lightning, which can be really powerful. So this is something to consider. Okay, with that out of the way, let's jump into the different elements. Let's take a look at these elements. We have, first of all, we have Heaven's Claws Blue, which is a fine blue, but it attacks for three. The fact that it blocks for three is like one of its best features. Double Blue Ball Lightning. The blue is interesting because you can pitch it away if you want to, but you can also just jam this down and your opponent has to think about whether or not they want to take one damage, which ends up being two damage, or drop a full card. And if you string this together with some other stuff, it can be kind of nasty. We do have two yellow Lightning Surges and a blue Lightning Surge. You want to see the reds. I think the red Lightning Surge is a power card in Sealed. If you see that, you should consider that kind of angle of just taking Lightning as one of your elements that you play. Shock Strikers are okay. They're not great. These ones attack for four, so you're happy about that, and that kind of fits in Lexi pretty well because they're yellow that goes for four, which is generally kind of okay. Blue Electrify. Electrifies are fantastic. If you see a lot of Electrifies, you should play Lightning because it is really, really good. Electrify is one of those cards where like you see this card in a lot, like in proliferation, and you just run it. Weave Lightnings, the red is fantastic, so that's really good. Flash in general is kind of okay. It makes more sense in Sealed, and it makes more sense in Lexi, I think, because you can kind of do some stuff with like go again triggers and things like that in Briar already, but you could consider this in Briar as well because it does really hit anything that Briar wants to play. And then just generally lightning presses are pretty good. So that's not a bad overall lightning pool. I've seen better. I've had better in sealed before, but there's a lot of playable stuff in here, so you could probably make it work. Ice, let's see how ice looks. Icy Encounter Red is fantastic. And then this weird double Polar Blast Red is kind of strange. It does give Dominate, and in a way, this can just win you the game, but you'd like to see these in blue, because in blue, you can pitch them away at least. Frostfang Red's pretty good. It attacks for 5. It'd be nicer if it blocked for like 3, but Weave Ice is fantastic. The red Weave Ice is super good. Winter's Grasp Yellow, not great. You don't want to see this card. You'd rather see it in blue because it could block 3. Winter's Bite Blue is not great. Frostfang Blue is not great. Chill to the Bone Blue is not great. You may run these just to pitch blue if you're trying to play Olden, but that is really not a super good ice pool. And then we do have some interesting cards in Earth. We have Earthlore Surge. Anytime you see any Earthlore Surge, you should think about going and what you could do with Earth as an element, because Earthlore Surge is one of those cards that really pushes you. So does Weave Earth. Weave Earth and Earthlore Surge are both of those, like, I can build a go tall deck and just do some damage. So those are both considerations, but unfortunately we have only one of each, and it's a blue and a yellow, and so that's a little bit strange. We do have double red Break Ground, and as a general generic, red Break Ground is pretty solid because it just pushes 7 damage if you can pay for it, and that's the thing. Yellow Burgeoning is it comes in for 6. The red Burgeoning is fantastic, and that comes across for 7 when arsenaled. Autumn's Touch you want to see in blue generally, but attacking for 6 is still good. A red So Tomorrow is pretty decent. Blue So Tomorrow is even better. Again, a lot of these cards are like, they're good cards fundamentally, and this, by the way, is actually a playable. A lot of people think this is not playable, but it actually is pretty playable. Red Summerwood Shelter, particularly the red one, because it can come down on any of these actions and make them block for 6. So this is a 2-card block for 6, and that's before you do any tricks with whatever hero you have. And so this card is actually playable. A lot of these element cards, you like them in general, but in the configurations that they are right now, you'd rather see them in other colors. So looking at the elements stack that we have blue Entwine Ice, blue Entwine Lightning, and blue Entwine Earth, which is kind of funny because, like, you'd want to see the red Entwine Lightning if you're playing Lightning. The Entwine Ice is generally just, the yellow one's pretty good, and then the red one's really good. And Entwine Earth, you're actually okay in blue. You're never really playing it, but if you do and you fuse it, it comes across for 6. It's not exactly the best fuse target. We do have 2 Invigorates. These are fine in Briar, because they at least help you, like, generate an Embodiment of Lightning token. And then I don't like Rejuvenate at all. This card probably almost never makes the cut into a deck. You can play this in like Control Briar, and it can be your second thing you do on that turn, your second action, and it can make an Embodiment of Lightning token, and you can float that to the next turn. Outside of that, it's really not good. Okay, so a kind of a mediocre overall sealed pool when it comes to those elements. So it may actually come down to what we can do with these and what we can do with like some of the power cards we already talked about. So let's go through and take a look at our arrows and see if we have a lot of red arrows. If we have a lot of red arrows, we can make something work. I'm gonna sort these really quick. All right, so after sorting, let's take a look. We do have what I think I counted 4 red arrows, so it's okay. It's okay. We have a red Frazzle, which you do want to fuse because you can do some cool things with that. We also have a yellow Frazzle, which is pushing the 4 breakpoint, so both of those are pretty solid. We've got a red Flake Out, which we don't really care about fusing because we can already give Dominate with the bow, but we can if we want to. But they both push 5 and 4 apiece, or 6 and 5 if you have the ability to fuse. 6-5 would dominate, like a 6 and then a 5. Chilling Ice Vein is one of those that's just like pure value. You don't really care about the effect. You can force a discard, which is kind of nice, but really they're just pure 5 and 4 attacks. Dazzling Crescendo is a card that you want to fuse because you do want to just get that go again off of the fuse effect so that you can, you know, play this from Arsenal and then, you know, Arsenal something after that. And that is a fantastic card to see. The 3 and the 2 we don't really like as much, but they do block for 3, and that's important to note. In this like meta, in this sealed meta, you want to know how many like of your cards block for 2 and how many block for 3, because you want to keep track of that as you go. If you can load up on 3 blocks, you're better for it. Buzz Bolt attacking for 4 yellow is pretty good. The blue not so much, but you don't care that much. Snapshot has almost no playability if you don't play like fusing it, you don't care about, because using the effect as though it were an instant, you can't give this go again. You can't do the like the death dealer trick, so this card doesn't really have much playability. Blizzard Bolt blue and Overflex blue. This would be great if it was like yellow or red, but even the blue I guess is okay. Is not too terribly bad. You want a couple of overflexes, I think. So this is a doable Lexi pile, and don't forget that you can also play Ice Storm and Fulminate. Fulminate you don't get both effects from because it's Earth and Lightning, but you do at least get the Lightning portion, which is the go again effect. Now, do keep in mind as well that both of these cards are playable in the next two heroes as well. So looking at our Oldham choices, we have Red Snow Wonder, which I absolutely love. It just attacks for 7 after you pitch a blue for it. We also have the blue version. I think we have 2 blue versions, which are both great as well for pitching. We have the granddaddy of them all, Thump. Red Thump, if you can provide a buff onto this, then this card is a game winner, an absolute game wrecker. Even the blue one can do the same thing if you can provide a buff for it. And then these Strength of Sequoias could be playable because you can Earth Fuse them, and if you Earth Fuse them, then it makes Thump playable by pitching a blue. That is a huge breakpoint change, so if you can establish a Strength of Sequoia with the Earth Fuse on it, you get that token. It makes things very good. Emerging Avalanches, if you just want to play Ice, adding your opponent's, giving your opponent like that Ice token, giving him the Frostbite is really good. Entangles, they're okay. These blue ones are great for pitching and for blocking with. The yellow one is kind of in that weird spot where, like, I don't really want to attack for 6 because it's an easy block if my opponent has 2 threes. But you can still play this because sometimes they just don't. Sometimes they just have a lot of 2s in this format. And then Glacial Footsteps, I like the blue a lot. I like the blue for Glacial Footsteps because this can be pitched early game and played late game and then just slammed down for the effect, or even just for 8 after pitching 2 blues alongside of this, if you can land a second cycle of your deck. And do keep in mind, we do have Rotten Old Buckler, and we do have Deep Blue to smooth out our resource base if we want to. Cracker Jack's also fantastic for Thump, so that is very, very interesting because it also means that we can play like Channel Mount Heroic and go for like a mixture of Ice and Earth cards, picking the best of like both worlds really. And then finally we have Runeblade, and this is what we got most cards of actually, so there's more cards here than there are anywhere else, and this means we would be able to tap into Earth and Lightning, which we did have some pretty decent pulls for if we sprinkled both in. Sigil of Suffering, the blue one can block for 2 and deal an arcane. The blue one's not great. Explosive Growth is okay if we have decent Earth Fusion stuff, but you generally want the red one because it can pump to 4. This one is like kind of mediocre. Rites of Replenishment is interesting because you can actually play like a Control Briar where you kind of set stuff to the bottom of your deck with Rites, but you need a good base to actually trigger off of these for your Earth cards. Arcanic Shockwaves you're always happy with. Basically anything that deals arcane damage is pretty decent in this format because it can't be blocked. These Veliflashes are mediocre. They attack for 4, the yellow ones do, but I don't think the blue one is that useful unless you plan to just block with it and pitch it away. We do have 2 Bramble Sparks, which are fine, or good cards overall because you're adding arcane. And then Stir the Wildwood. This is the card you want to see if you want to just jam down giant things. I think Stir the Wildwood, is like super underrated. This is like the Runeblade Thump. This card's so good. And we have 2 reds, which are great, and a yellow. So, like, this is a very, very heavy pull into, like, Earth Briar, in my opinion. So we should look at our Earth base again after that. Singeing Steelblade's really good in red. We have 2 blues also, which can, by the way, just block for 3 and pop an arcane, which is okay. And then finally we have a probably unplayable Inspire Lightning, which is a little bit funny. It doesn't do much for us. If we play a lot of lightning and we confuse it, it deals 2. So it could be just like that ending burn spell overall. So after looking at all of this, I'm immediately thinking, okay, I could probably make like an Oldham thing work, that's not bad, as long as I can get enough blues across the board for you know, as far as these things go. I could very much make Briar work, and I hope that looking back at these Earth cards, we can get enough decent Earth cards to kind of fit this together and get enough non-attacks in both Earth and Lightning. So let's take a look at that first. So these are our options as far as what we could do with an Earth and Lightning Briar. I did leave out some Earth cards. I left out like Lightning Surge Yellow, Yellow Blue, and then the two Yellow Shock Strikers, because I don't feel like they provide that much. The Lightning Surges, if you get them into Arsenal, yes, those are pretty good. They come across for three. Three coming across with Go Again is pretty decent, especially if you can Channel Mount Heroic them. So you may want to swap out like a few of these Lightning cards. Overall, these are the Lightning cards that I had access to, and there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 of them, plus these over here that we talked about that I don't really care too much about. This right here, not counting the equipment at the top that are our options, this is 33 cards, so we would probably want to cut these down a little bit. I'm not crazy about a few of these cards. I wish we had these in different colors, but the main thing we would want to do with a deck like this is we'd want to find these stirs, set them up to a turn where we can kind of like Bramble Spark or some you know, like Arcanic Shockwave with Go Again off of like, you know, playing a double action on the previous turn, something like that, or on that turn if you have some bonkers hand. Basically, we want to be able to pump Stir the Wildwood up. We want to play these like Rites of Replenishment pretty strongly. We have decent overall you know, like Earth card access. We could maybe cut a few of these Earth cards, but I think the Earth cards are probably more important than anything as far as fuse effects. Getting a fuse effect off on Bramble Spark is okay. This is pretty good. Like the yellow one's pretty good. The blue one you don't care about fusing for. In general, we don't care to fuse a lot of these except the stirs. Fusing the Rites of Replenishment does allow us some recursion in our deck because it does fetch a card from graveyard and put it back into your deck, which is pretty good. And then, of course, these Singeing Steel Blades are generally okay to just jam down there, especially if you can create some go-again effects. So this is not a bad option. It leaves you with a decent number of non-attack action cards with go-again so that you can set up the you know, Embodiment of Lightning token, and it does also mean that if you have some attacks that come across and hit, like these Breakpoint Singeings and Arcanic Shock Waves, if those do connect, then you're creating those Embodiment of Earth tokens and giving yourself some decent value. Blue Sigil's not great. You could cut maybe Blue Sigil, even though it does deal arcane. You could cut a few of these you know, electric lightning stuff, because there's a couple of those that you don't really care about to fuse. I mean, that's all your fuse base right there. You only want to fuse two things, so you can cut here, you could maybe cut an Invigorate, you could maybe cut this Sigil of Suffering and get it down to a nice lean 30 card deck. It's not the best thing in the world, but it does provide you some options, and again, if you can tune yourself down to 30 cards and know exactly what your game plan is, you're going to play better than someone who just kind of piles a bunch of cards together of all, you know, like elements and that sort of thing, and just tries to hit you with a bunch of damage. All right, so this is a possible Oldham deck that we could put together. This one's a little bit weak in my mind as far as just playable and power level is concerned. I mean, we do have power level in Channel Mount Heroic, and that is very good. But oftentimes we're just playing like one attack a turn when it comes to playing Oldham, and sometimes you even play a little bit more defensively than other classes. This Fulminate, I really don't think it's that big of a deal in Oldham, so this could be a cuttable card. This is a 31 card deck before I removed that one, so now it's a 30 card deck. We do have some powerful plays like Emerging Avalanche and Strength of Sequoia. Pumping up any of our attacks in the future turn is really good, even if you don't fuse those cards. Red Thump, Red Snow Under are all fantastic. I like Red Icy Encounter because it makes your opponent full block. Two Red Break Grounds, you could maybe take that to one. You could possibly take one of these Polar Blasts out as well. Those feel a little bit weak to me, but you kind of want some blues so that you can at the very least you know, do some tricky stuff with blue, with, I say blues, with ice cards, I should say. Like fusing Snow Under is really good. But you can cut some of your fuse base here because you don't care about fusing a ton. You could even cut this strength of Sequoia, but it does feel a little bit weak in general. You don't want this many yellows usually, but I will say this, a lot of times you're playing some of these things that do cost two, so yellows do have more utility than in most Guardian decks. This is where you want to look, and I really had to squeeze to find like blues that are generally pretty good, and overall it's not terrible. Like, we do have a lot of blues that block three, but I would love to see like generally more blues, and luckily we do have deep blue, which does help us kind of smooth that out on a key turn. As far as equipments are concerned, I feel really comfortable with this equipment. Like, this Cracker Jacks plus Thump is like, you can just win the game off of that. And having a Rotten Old Buckler is really, really good. So in that respect, I do feel really comfortable. It would just be piloting the deck and knowing your blue counts and knowing your power level and your threats and trying to parse those out in a way that allows you to kind of win the game when you want to win the game, and then protecting yourself throughout as well is just, it's one of those things that I kind of look at it and I'm like, yeah, you could maybe make this work, but I did feel like I had to put a lot of like subpar cards in here to get this blue count to where it needed to be, and like red Polar Blast feels a little uncomfortable. So you could play this and it would be doable for Oldham, but it does feel a little shaky, and if you're playing against a lot of good players, this one may be a little tough to work around. And then finally we have Lexi. Lexi is kind of weird in this pool as well. All of these pools are really weird, which I think is great, because you may end up with something like this, and hopefully if you do and you watch this video, you can kind of parse your way through what you would want to choose. As far as Lexi, we're still running Deep Blue, and then you can choose between Cracker Jack and Mark of Lightning. In this instance, I do think Mark of Lightning seems pretty decent over Cracker Jack, but if you wanted to run Cracker Jack, it can land on just about anything, and that's really good. Ice Storm is going to be pretty fantastic here. We're not probably going to fuse this, because really our ice base is not great for Lexi. Like, we could have pulled a couple of more ice cards out, but really, I mean, looking at these ice cards, it's like blues, maybe you think about a blue Frost Fang. These two red Polar Blasts I thought about for a little bit. You could probably swap those in. It's Forces Dominate, so if you wanted to build your blue base up, you could. But really, there's not, I don't like those cards. This Chill to the Bone makes some sense, so maybe you do jam that, because if you push any damage over the top, it does make a Frostbite token. But generally, you're not going to worry about fusing Ice Storm, even if you... the effect is fantastic, of course, but the Ice Storm in general just gives a plus three. The Fulminate gives a lot of go again. This card is not great, by the way. I didn't put Snapshot, but that's the only arrow I didn't put into this. These two you could think about subbing out, but as far as arrows are concerned, a lot of these are pretty fantastic. Like just red and yellow Frazzle, Chilling Ice Vein, red and yellow, all of the Dazzling Crescendos, because they can gain go again, and we have a ton of playable overall lightning cards, and so this in general sets us up nicely to be able to turn over, reveal a Shock Striker, for example, give your next attack go again, attack with a Shock Striker, load an arrow, attack with an arrow, giving it Dominate or whatever you want to give it. So overall, this seems pretty playable in general. Chilling Ice Vein, you don't really care to fuse, so your ice base is lower, who cares? The Yellow Buzz Bolt, you'd want to fuse that, you'd want to fuse your Frazzles, you'd want to fuse your Dazzling Crescendos, and we have enough lightning to push that damage. So this one feels a lot more comfortable than Oldham, and for me, it would teeter between this or the Briar build. The Briar build allows you to kind of go taller. This one does give you some setup for going wide, and I think you may be able to get there with either of those decks. Basically, due to the fact that we have so many decent playable lightning, like our lightning pool was overall pretty decent, and we had pretty decent pulls here for our arrows with a couple of red arrows, a decent number of red arrows. You don't care about fusing Flake Out, but it just attacks for five, it attacks for five, it attacks for five, it attacks for four. All these yellow ones, like there and there and there, all attack for four as well. So this one feels pretty comfortable, and the Briar one felt good if you can like line up and then jam down a couple of non-attacks, push one of those smaller attacks with go again because of the embodiment of lightning token that you created, and then come over the top with like a giant Stir of the Wildwood. Super underrated build there, and I think this one has some general power level across the board with our equipment, with these Majestics that could be playable. Even Fulminate's pretty decent in this deck because it can give go again off the top. and we have the resources to pay for any of these effects. So overall, a pretty nice and lean deck here. So there you go. That is an entire walkthrough of a sealed pool where you may see something like this in the calling. And if you do, hopefully you have some understanding of how to go through a process, look at each of the heroes, look at each of their bases, and see what kinds of things you'd want to be able to build with those. What would be successful? Hopefully you can find some value in this and take it with you to the calling DFW and to the calling Cincinnati, where both main events are going to be sealed into draft. If you want more info on the sealed format, or if you want to know about draft, I made comprehensive guides on both sealed and draft in Flesh and Blood over on my channel, youtube.com/DMArmada. And if you want to pick up more of this set, don't forget you can go to channelfireball.com, buy your heart out when it comes to picking up Tales of Aria, because they have a ton of it. If you want to use my affiliate code and support me, it's DMArmada at checkout. I would thoroughly appreciate it if you do plan on picking some stuff up from Channel Fireball. If you'd like to come hang out with me over on my channel, it's youtube.com/DMArmada. We'd love to have you over there. We're doing a lot of openings and deck techs and stuff like that. So if you enjoy that content, come on over and join me. And as always, everybody, thanks for watching.